will call the order and roll call, please.
Judy Nelson?
Here.
Tom Coons?
Is delayed and or excused, however it works out, and
Tom, Emily Leach?
Here.
Andrea Anderson?
Here.
Erin Cavan?
Here.
We will stand in pledge.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
All right. It's nice that the rain has started, since we all started coming in. Comments by visitors? I see no comments by visitors, we'll move on. The consent calendar consists of the March minutes and April enrollment. There's been no change since the March enrollment. So those are the two items. Board's pleasure on consent calendar?
I have a question about the minutes.
Yes.
Page 10, 26, there seems to be a random page that was inserted that's not part of the minutes. I don't know.
Maybe a page before it's missing?
Maybe, maybe a page before it's missing.
You mean of the entire packet, you mean, not in the minutes. So in the entire packet, there's a random page.
Correct.
Yes.
Yes.
Yes, that is not the minutes.
Okay, sorry.
So we can, there does, and I have a question on that, too.
Okay.
So we'll see the
Do you want me to use it?
So we'll see what that comes up, but it is not part of the actual
Okay, gotcha.
I make motion to accept.
Second.
Any further discussion? All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
It says I have a random page.
Oh, okay.
I find that sort of what that is. I think it goes with something else. All right, we're we'll get to that. We'll get to that. We'll see if it goes with anything, and then we'll discuss it. If it is, I almost think I know where it goes, but maybe not. All right, announcements.
So I have just two things that I wanted to share with everyone. Some of you know, and some of the public doesn't know, that back on March 22nd, I believe the SAU board met and officially approved our own Katie Krause as the business administrator. She has been in an interim role, as many of you know, since Marie Dagostino retired at the end of December. So she's been fulfilling that role and doing a fantastic job. So we were able to move forward with the unanimous approval. So we're excited about that and wanted to let everybody know that that was the case. And we will be advertising shortly for her replacement in the exactly what it's going to be, assistant, bookkeeping assistant role. So that will be coming soon.
Excellent.
And, yeah, so
and that has not been posted yet?
Yeah, she's going to post it tomorrow.
Is she? Okay.
We made some adjustments to the posting. And
okay. I knew we were working on it, so.
Great.
And then the other thing that I want to mention, and we've talked about this a few times with those security grants. Bronsford got moved to a wait list, which is not I guess the worst thing in the world, they didn't say no, so that's, you know, encouraging. However, what they ended up doing, I think I explained last time, is that they came up with a state kind of added an arbitrary deadline date that they, I guess, created themselves and didn't know anything about. So we were at this grant was submitted after that date. So they kind of took all of those other projects, they funded the ones before that at the levels that they chose to fund that, and then anything that came in after that was, you know, subject to other, you know, decisions. And so they had recommended the project, but we waited to see what funds were actually available. And now the project, they had a meeting and then put the project on the wait list. The committee that makes those decisions is meeting again at the end of this month, so April 30. We are hopeful that, because they did have some money left, and they were waiting and finding out from districts that they had given the money to, because a lot of projects didn't get fully funded, if they would still be able to use the funds that they received to complete their project. So if districts said, no, we needed this full amount, then we can't just use the smaller amount,
so, and are they quick about getting the word out so they know? We should know where, May meeting?
Absolutely.
Excellent. I just have a couple of things. The New Hampshire School Board Association workshop for board members and chairs is May 2nd in Concord from 5 to 8, if anyone is interested in going. If you are interested in going, Lori should be notified immediately so we can be paid. If anyone's interested in going. Many of you may have seen signs around town, the duck race, which raises money for the Ballinsford Garden Club, gardens and trails down on the way to the beach down there. Duck race is one of their major fundraisers, and it will be on May 5th at 2 p.m. during Open Studios down there. It's a fun event, absolutely fun event. Friends at Public Library chocolate tasting, because you really can't watch a duck race without a plate full of chocolate goodies. At least that's the way I've done it now that that's done. And one last thing is that Bob Godomsky, our how do they say this now in school? It's almost like a rising senior, our rising superintendent, I guess. I don't know. Incoming. Has asked to join us for our May meeting. So he'll be here. We'll give him a little bit of time to chat with folks and sit in on the meeting. So he'd like to sort of jumpstart getting to know us and the community a bit. So, all right. So that's it for announcements. Any other communications? All right. Discussion items. The principal update.
And I don't know, Judy, if you want to, just because I think it's going to require some discussion, if you want to let Bailey just go first, I think that's entirely up to you. I just think it's going to be some discussion.
I'm sure Bailey would appreciate it.
Sure.
All right. And then Bailey, the option from some sort.
Right. So our student council has two field trips coming up in the next, 5 days. So we have a team bonding trip to the Boston Museum of Science tomorrow. I'm taking advantage of that teacher workshop. This is a time to get together towards the end of the year and celebrate all that we've done. And then we have a spring conference for the New Hampshire League of Student Councils, and that'll be on Tuesday. We're doing a beach cleanup in Rye, I believe. We've done this. This is the second year we'll be doing this, just as an effort to do our part. And then our National Honor Society is, there's a group of us at the Riverside Rest Home tonight. We're doing a bingo night for the residents. This is our second year doing this as well, and last year it was such a good, such good experience, so we're doing that again. And then tomorrow we have our teacher luncheon for this month's teacher workshop, and we're also doing a scholarship workshop for seniors to fill out scholarships that time frame as a designated slot for them. And then we have our Krispy Kreme fundraiser. This is the second one that we're doing this year. Again, it was really successful the first time around, so we're trying to raise more money for scholarships to give out. So that'll be starting next week. We also have elections next week for new officers. We're trying to do it earlier than we did last year because there are no returning officers. So we're going to do that so that we can kind of work alongside them and have the outgoing officers pair with the new or incoming officers so that way we can kind of have that little bond going. And then we also have our second blood drive of the year on May 11th. And there's a scholarship opportunity with the blood drive. Reach a certain amount of units, two people will get a scholarship for that, which is awesome. As far as our classes go, the freshmen have planned two car washes in the next couple of months, and the sophomores are planning various fundraisers. The juniors are in full-on prom mode. Their prom is May 19th, so this is the, actually next week is the last week to buy tickets. Tickets are $75. And then the senior class, we have a Panera fundraiser tonight. And then on April 19th, we are partnering with a small business in Somersworth. It's called The Gathering Place. So we're going to have a little, paint night as a fundraiser with that. And then we're also having a booth at the Spring Craft Fair on May 5th at Somersworth High School. And then as far as sports go, there's a baseball game tomorrow at home versus Wittesquam at 4 p.m. And also a softball game tomorrow at 4 p.m. And then the juniors will be doing science testing next week as their standardized test, and we have April break starting following week, April 23rd.
And if you'd like to share, I heard you share it with some people, you've decided where you'll be be attending?
I have. I will be going to Lesley University in the fall.
Fantastic. Congratulations.
Thank you.
So when you say fall, what is the actual?
Yeah.
When do you have to show up?
It's Memorial Day weekend, so it's like very.
Labor Day.
Labor Day.
Because otherwise, I'm like, wow.
It's not early.
The beginning of September. Yes.
We know you're an enthusiastic student.
Right there.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
Exciting.
As usual, you are welcome to stay.
I'm gonna go play big stuff.
Okay. I'll call out a good number.
Thank you. How many?
Now we'll go back to the principal update. Talk about what's happening. I came in.
Okay.
Yeah.
I'm not sure.
I'm sorry, she has.
No, that's what I want. So mine's just out of Google. I can't share it with Google, so I can put it in Word, so it's probably the easiest.
Oh.
You're right.
There's enough.
There's a typo.
You sent me.
I must have a different.
It wasn't in mine.
Yeah, it wasn't in mine.
Well, it's a separate email.
This apparently has no typos.
Better not. Finally, tell me, Erin.
I marked up the other one, I won't say.
Well, that's why you have a new one, because there were a couple typos.
If everyone read mine, it was probably.
I didn't.
I realized it.
I was nervous when I sent her an email.
All right.
Wait, so you gave extras?
Yeah. Yeah, so there are two extras.
So do you want to bring us up to date with what's happening in the building first, or jump right into this?
No, sure, I can put this to a regular update first.
Sure.
So I don't know if you've heard or not, but we had Peter Pan here last weekend. It was, in the 7 years I've been here, it was the most incredible performance. The kids were so spectacular and so invested and so committed. Jeannie and Lori did an exceptional job, as you would expect. And Jeannie just shined in every piece of it. It was just her that brought it to life. Standing room only both nights. Packed house. It was just spectacular. It was such a great moment for RGS and for Jeannie and for all those kids that worked so hard. There's some, Fiona's dad, Gillis, Mr. Gillis, same Mike, right? Came and taped it so we can burn it on DVDs for people, because so many people wanted to have that. Yeah. So you can see it. Mrs. Phipps, Mrs. Spear, and Mrs. Nichols, students performed on Wednesday night for their spring musical at school. The little kids were just harping, and they're so cute. It was great. Upcoming things, we have Nature's Classroom for our 5th and 6th graders, which is May 29th through June 1st. So our kids will be in Nature's Classroom, which is like the capstone of all things for our kids at the end of 5th and 6th grade in their RGS experience. Additionally, our 3rd and 4th grade team, which is Mrs. Spear and Mrs. Station, have 5 field trips planned for their kids at the end of the year to bring them to the State House and just all these different locations to sort of celebrate New Hampshire at the end of the year. They've got some great trips planned. They have one, they're going to the Sea Dogs, and I think they have the same number of adults as they do kids, because every single parent wants to go, which is pretty cute. Teacher Appreciation Week begins May 7th. The central office has already informed us of the day that they do breakfast for the staff once during Teacher Appreciation, that is on the 8th. And then I have something, if you know, we do something every day. PTO is also bringing lunch for them one day, so this week will be special, which is great. The 6th grade lock-in is May 18th, which is the night that the entire 6th grade student body spends the night with us locked in RGS.
So what day is that?
May 18th. It's a little bit early this year. Nature's Classroom is part of that. Memorial Day weekend plays into that. And then there's just so many, like, it's on a Friday, and so this is the only time we could have it. What else? The REF is doing their final fundraiser of the year. That is available on the RGS Facebook page and on their Facebook page. It's available if you want to buy hanging plants from Wentworth Gardens. And then PTO is sending home their calendar fundraiser tomorrow. So they do a month of raffles for gift cards on each day, and that goes home with kids tomorrow. And I will just kind of shout out to the Teachers Association, they bought 10 of the gift cards for the fundraiser to help support PTO and just sort of pay back all the times PTO. It's been helpful for them to just kind of reciprocate. It was really nice of them to do that. So I think those are like the events that are going on that are super exciting. We started extended day on Monday. Everybody's exhausted, but it has gone off without a hitch. Like, there's been no busing issues, there's been no parents being confused. We have some of our kids getting extended related arts to make up for some of the things they've missed, and that's gone really well. So it's been really smooth, even though we're exhausted, which is nice. I also wanted to touch on the things that we're doing in the building. We have our configurations for next year. So we looked at where our enrollment was, where our blips were, and our configurations and our teacher assignments have been done. We built our schedule for next year, which is really early for us, which is really nice. We're starting class placements and thinking about the dynamics and what our kids need to be where to have their needs met. We know what spaces are changing over the summer, so rec department will have a classroom in the building that they can use. That's one of the things they were really looking forward to having. So that's all set, and the room will be cleared out 3 days after we get out of school, so there'll be plenty of time for rec to come in and set up, which is always a little bit tricky when we're, you know, within a day of each other. So those things are all going swimmingly well.
Excellent.
Yes. Did I talk as fast as Bailey?
No.
We've been bouncing it all out.
Bailey gets it all out quickly. Has anything started with the cupola yet? I know the weather has not been conducive. Just checking.
Sure. So we had hoped to have the cupola done over April vacation, but the gentleman was afraid he wouldn't have it done, and then he'd be mid-project with us coming back to school. So we will start the, what is it, the 18th? We have the 15th. He starts on the 18th. It's all booked to start.
Okay.
Oh, I should have, I'm sorry. I have other things to talk about with the facilities. I apologize. The ceiling tiles in the downstairs of the main building, it's done over April vacation, so we have budgeted every year to start doing the ceiling tile replacement. That starts over vacation. The dumpster will be delivered on Monday. We are purging the attic so it can be, we don't have to worry about things falling through, which is really good. We have the two sheds that are remaining. The ones are in very good shape at softball, though there's just a couple wood pieces that need to be replaced, and they'll be painted and done over vacation. We have some community service kids helping with that, which is great. The flag will be done over vacation, and then the front steps start on Monday of vacation. He may even come over the weekend to start on the front steps. He came this week to he'd come earlier and said he had to wait till it was warm enough and dry enough. And he came back again this week and said he thinks he's going to start this weekend, if not very beginning of vacation. So those are getting done. Katie and I have been talking about drafting the RFP for the roof, so that can go out soon, so we can get that project scheduled. So those are the facility updates.
Thank you very much. Now we can, now are we going into the other part of it?
Yes. So I had been coming to you for a while talking about this, but really feeling like I needed to fully flesh it out and meet with all, everybody that would have a stake in what I was trying to propose or pull together. And so that's been happening, I guess, for 3 or 4 months now. I don't want to go over all of this. So a law changed in the state. There was a dyslexia law passed that affects every public school in the state. And we weren't really sure what the implications were going to be for our school, because it, or any school for that matter, because it just started this September. So we weren't really sure what that would mean for us as an entire school. What we have come to realize is that it means we have students that we're not servicing the way we should be servicing them. What I mean by that is if a student is screened and they are show indicators of being a student that has a dyslexic brain, we are required by law to provide intervention services for those students. At this time, we can use our Title I tutor to do that for students in kindergarten through third grade. We cannot, Title I only goes up to third grade. So then any student in fourth, fifth, and sixth doesn't have, we don't have a person in our building that does that right now. So that's the first part. The second part is that Title I is just Tier 2. What we also know about students with a dyslexic brain is they sometimes need a Tier 3, which is in addition to the Tier 2, they need a Tier 3, which is additional time and more explicit intervention. We don't have anybody that does that kindergarten through sixth grade. So we are understaffed to provide the services we need to provide for literacy intervention, particularly for students that have or show signs of having a dyslexic brain and similar language disorders. I say that, the question I always get is, well, then are they special ed? So I'm going to clear that up a little bit. It's very confusing. And it's, I will tell you, because the laws are changing across the country, that we are very much in flux. So each state is sort of trying to deal with this because it's changing. In New Hampshire, in order to qualify for special education under specific learning disability, which is what dyslexia falls under, you also have to have a processing deficit, which means, so your, the speed at which your brain processes information, visual information versus auditory information, long-term retrieval. So you have to have a deficit as well as being dyslexic. So oftentimes, students that present with having a dyslexic brain do not have a processing deficit. So they cannot qualify for special ed services. So again, currently at RGS, we don't have those personnel to provide services. You're either special ed or regular ed. We don't have that middle, the intervention staffing. And so we're in a bind that we need to rectify immediately because we're doing a disservice for children. Not intended, and this was clearly not intention, and it sort of came up out of a law change and some unexpected budget cuts that we've had over time, and how that sort of has just evolved and changed. And we have, as I've been talking about, a number of kids that are coming in now with significant needs, that more so than any other time.
So this is something that needs, you said immediate addressing, and like, do you mean immediate as in even starting this year? This school year?
So we, knowing this, we've been pooling our resources and figuring it out. But yeah, if we could do it this year, that'd be great. I think we're not going to find somebody in May of this year to fill that role, especially someone that's qualified. So it's this specific type of intervention and support requires a very qualified person, and it's not just anybody.
So I have a couple questions others may as well. You said if a child is tested, or so does every child get tested? Or
every child screens.
Oh, okay, screens.
So part of the law is that every single student is screened.
Okay. You said if, so I wasn't sure if every child was.
Oh, I'm sorry. Yeah, so every student has to be, is required by law to be screened.
Okay, and that, and that's the new law that every child must be screened.
Yes. Yeah.
Okay. Does anyone
have any questions? And that's as we enter kindergarten. Any coming into the school?
So any new student to us, any new kindergartner, and anytime we, any teacher thinks there might be any reason, because they didn't come in and say all sixth graders. They tried to like start us and kind of roll us out, but it also dictates any student that there's concern about and then is screened. So it could be a fourth grader, it could be a second grader, it could be a sixth grader. But the screening happens mandatorily now for every new kid and every kindergartner.
And you're seeing increase in need.
Yeah. And I think the hard part, I think, and I'll speak for myself, with dyslexia is the science and the understanding is evolving tremendously even now as we're sitting here. So what we knew a year ago is different than what we know now. We're learning just more and more about it. I mean, they're predicting 20% of our population, which is like a staggering percentage of our population, and we're not staffed for it. So it's a lot is evolving in a very short amount of time.
Who's this person that we would need? Is it a special ed teacher? What's the...
I think we would look for... I think you could look, I think it could be coming from a variety. It could be just a certified teacher with training in one of these areas. It could be a literacy specialist. It could be a special ed teacher with, but it's a specific training that they have to have in order to meet the needs of these kids. And I think in my mind, from what, everything I'm gathering or learning about dyslexia, is that the more experiences and expertise, the better, because the response to the child and changing it up all the time is really, really important. And if someone doesn't know how to do that or doesn't have a wealth of information to pick from, they're not going to be able to respond as quickly to those students' needs as we would want them to.
I have a great deal of experience with dyslexia. I come from, I have a sister who's extremely dyslexic. I'm dyslexic, but a point that would never have been picked up because I don't have any other processing things. And so I've had experience with it. And I also spent the early part of my career in public education working with what were called, they actually called it a learning disability at the time, working with dyslexic children. Because at that time, a lot was done physically with them. And I hope that continues. But as the physical education teacher in K-3, I spent hours each day working with students that were identified as dyslexic. And it's amazing working with those students. And I'm just glad to see the science. And when we started, you didn't even realize it was a spectrum. That someone could be mildly dyslexic or tremendously. So it's great to see it come a long way since the 70s. And I'm very much, we'll talk more about this a little bit later. I think it's something we really have to address.
outset, you know the information about Title I?
Yes, it was actually mentioned last month, but so the Title I news that we learned last month, and sort of to reiterate it, is that it's sort of good news, it's sort of a good news, bad news thing in some ways. Rollinsford as a community has always had around 18-19% free and reduced lunch. And it has now dropped to below 6%, I believe, or something. So good news is that we don't have a community that, I guess that's good news, but and I don't see how we can call it bad news, but we'll be losing funding because of that.
There's a twofold part to that, just so you know. So there's the funding of the position. There's also all Title I materials that were bought with Title I funds have to be boxed up and then put away for a year. And then if we qualify again, we can unbox them.
Yeah. Yes. So that's books, computers, things like, yeah, please go ahead, Andrew.
Like, yes. Boxed up for no one to use?
Yes.
Like, at this point?
Really?
Yes.
So who makes up that decision? I don't understand
the federal government. These are federal funds. I believe, right? They're federal funds, right?
No, but they were already purchased at this point, right? So I don't understand the...
None of us do.
So I do, I would propose, or I would ask, that the board consider, we need those materials to provide services for our students. And so whether it's decided this board meeting or next board meeting, we'll know more in May. I have a list of the materials that we, not all the materials, but the ones we would absolutely have to have for our students next year, period. I have and their prices so that you guys can entertain potentially buying those materials this year if we have to, in fact, box up our material. And
well, we do have to, right? I mean,
so Caroline Butler, I'm begging, I have been literally groveling with Caroline, and she has been groveling for me with the state, because there are four factors that determine whether or not you get Title I funds. Free and reduced lunch is just one of them. It's not promising, and I'm not saying it to like get our hopes up, but I'm also not giving up. So I think we'll know more in May, but I feel like you guys should know now the situation that we're in when it comes to, it's not just the person which we would need, it's the materials we would need.
So disgusting. So I'm sorry, I just can't get beyond this. I don't understand, can someone help me understand why the state, I understand they don't want to provide any more funding if we don't qualify, but I don't understand the boxing up of the materials.
It's federal money that paid for these materials, and so they are saying you cannot use our materials if you are not receiving our funds.
So they're already purchased,
yep.
And when we were qualified, we're not asking for more.
Correct.
Do we give them back?
No,
if in a year we do not qualify again, then yes, we give them all back. They allow them to be housed here, boxed up, and not used for a year while we see if we qualify the following year.
But after a year, they probably even can't use them.
I was just saying, right. They can move to another school,
Yes, well,
they probably redistributed.
Yeah, you know, Laura said redistributed, and to me, it's like they didn't even put a provision for if you'd like to rent them. You know, because that would be a lot easier for us than going out and purchasing them. We'd love to, you know, we would rent them. But I mean, apparently there's no such provision.
I just think it's important information for you guys to have because it's a big financial.
So you will have that list for us next.
I have it available whenever you want it.
Okay.
I don't think we need to make a decision now because we still have another month before we'll know information. But I didn't want to spring it on you.
And we'll know a lot more in another month also about the grant and whatnot. So we'll talk about it. But we'll talk about it when we get to the budget because it looks like we'll be able to make some decisions. Thank you. That was a lot. Thank you.
So many good things going on.
Any other questions of Kate?
Did you change your mind?
Yes, I was swayed by that Title I decision.
So I believe we have already determined the last day of school. It is the Friday, the
June 15th.
Friday, June 15th, right. Okay. And
for students. Teachers will
right,
be out
for
on
students.
Monday and Tuesday.
So that's already done.
That's a full day.
Yes.
All right. The next discussion item is discuss this back, once the union contract passed, and it will be signed, I hope this week, I intend to, hopefully tomorrow, get to it. I know I'll probably swing over here tomorrow or one day.
Oh, yeah.
That would have a little ceremony.
I'm not in the office tomorrow, so I brought it.
That would have a little ceremony.
Good planning.
It's been reviewed by both the union and negotiators, and we're going forward with the signing, which is great. But one of the things that we, as a board, put off to make sure that it passed and all that was talking about putting non-union staff, and that would be the principal, the administrative assistant, and the custodians. I believe that's it.
And the facilities director.
Well, that's, I'm sorry, I count as a custodian. And the facilities director, sorry. You know, you're absolutely right, facilities director. Moving them to the same health plan. I think this is good timing for us to think about doing it. We have a new principal coming in. It looks like we have enough money in the budget to be able to, sort of at the end of the year, give them a stipend toward it for next year. And then, because we didn't have a chance to put it in their, compensation, we already gave them a 2%, we might give them a 2.5% if we know we're going to do this. I think we have room we can talk about either under budget or non-public, and then come out and vote on it, but that we could give them a bit of a stipend for the out-of-pocket expenses that they'll experience because of that.
And this plan saves money over the long term just because it's the same plan that
yes,
staff are using.
It does two things. It saves us money with current staffing. And we know staffing is about to change, but with current staffing, it saves us about $10,000. And the other thing it does is it puts everyone in the building on the same plan, which makes it just tons easier, I believe, to administer.
Last year, when that was going in front of the town, Jenny had already said to me, if that happens, your health insurance would change too. So
yes,
it sort of presented us our head of time. I mean, I know it was a year ago, but that was the potential of what would happen.
Yes, and we had that discussion. The board actually, I think, had that discussion with Jenny last year that we were definitely going to do it. But this year, we had not made a definite decision. So
I think everybody here has already been told that might happen.
They're sort of figuring out that's what's going to happen. So our decision would be what we might want to do first, I think. Let's see if we can do that. So,
Do we need a motion to place them on that healthcare plan?
We probably do. And we probably do. Just to make sure everything's covered.
Make a motion to place them, union RDS staff, on the yellow health insurance plan.
Second. Any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? All right. Motion carries that we will be doing that, and we'll have a stipend discussion afterwards. In our packet is the 2018-2019 already. Yes. Calendar.
Mm-hmm.
Isn't that like amazing?
Mm-hmm.
Kate's like shaking her head. No, I don't understand.
I think it's a different way.
Well, before we had already sent the packet out, so I'm going to share it with you.
Yes.
And the first calendar.
And, all right. So what we have the initial calendar, but by contract and every other way, we also want the school, the principal and union to have a look at it as well. So there's a new one. Is that where we are?
And that's what you have in front of you. So this is something that Kate did with the staff.
So I think that we would probably, I'm sorry. So probably what we'll do is not have a long discussion about this today unless someone would like to speak to us or see you guys, because it'll take a little time to look at the differences. And
I can tell you.
Yeah, I was going to say.
Okay.
So there are a couple of things that the school wanted to do. The first was to align a couple of the workshops with Summersworth, both the special ed staff and the nurse. Mm-hmm. We're looking for a few of those, and so in order to do that, we changed three of the workshop days in the spring to line up with Summersworth, which was one of the motivations. Additionally, we wanted to...
those are the yellow ones, right?
Those are...
Teacher workshops?
Yep.
Yep.
And then we wanted to also have as many days as possible aligned to Marshwood for our students' purposes, meaning that, for example, if you were to look at October 5th, that is a workshop day in Marshwood, so we also made it one of our workshop days, so all the kids would be off on the same time. time. Summersworth will be going to school, I mean, we'll have the day off on December 21st, that Friday. But Marshwood was not going to, so we went with that. So our older kids are at Marshwood, our kids will be here that day. So that's another day that was different from the original calendar.
Okay.
And then that's pretty much identical to what you saw before.
Yep, okay. And that's good. And one of the things I had seen in the ones that got sent is that I had to look to align to look at Marshwood and...
We did both Marshwood and Summersworth.
Right, and we usually do align them, so, yep. So this is great work. Excellent. So I don't see, I think we'll leave it for a vote until next time, just in case any of us want to look at it more closely. Okay.
Correct, because we had in the packet what we have drafted in
yeah.
the office, plus you also have Marshwood's calendar for next year, so if you wanted to lay them all out.
Yeah,
so
well, which is pretty much this, it is pretty much this. The only thing we would do is, one of the things I think we do need to note is first day of school for Marshwood.
They don't go until after Labor Day.
Right, right. They start the Tuesday after Labor Day.
Yep.
And that's the only other thing you know. You're
and they're also done earlier than we are. Yep. Their last day next year is the 10th. We cannot be done on that day. So we're on day.
One never knows. So we'll table it and take action next week. Oh, unless there's a different thought.
You've laid them out. I mean, I'm okay.
Yeah. And central office, she's with me.
Kate and I talked
about it. Yeah, to you, Judy.
No, that's fine. No, then why don't we adopt it now? Save time next time.
Move to adopt the 2018-19 school calendar.
Okay. Any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
All right. This is the official one. I am actually writing official on it. An action item today is the professional staff nominations list. This is something that we do every year. The superintendent presents to us the staff that are being nominated for.
Sorry, I'm being distracting. I spilled.
She can.
Oh my God. It's just the way the day is going.
Yeah, it's
the day. So we have a complete list, and we have a new list.
With one change.
Office, we have
administrative staff.
Kate is obviously missing. So there is a name missing, which you will see come down the list. Well, we can. So if people have questions, what we will do is table this and go into non-public, and then at the end, and then come back out and nominate whatever. So I would like to suggest that we probably table discussion at the moment until we get to non-public. Does that make sense to folks?
Yes.
Over there. All right. So. Tabling this for non-public first, and then we'll discuss it non-public and come out and take any action, whatever action we need to take before we come out of non-public. All right. All right. Budget. And this is where I noted that the Title I funds have been already been told have been reduced for 18-19. Katie, is there anything?
Just a couple of things I want to mention. I noticed that special ed transportation, we haven't really spent anything.
Yes, I
so
have.
So I've talked to, well, maybe spent some, but not in a few reports. It's been kind of the same. Mm-hmm. So I brought it up to special ed, and they're going to be looking at that and find out why.
Okay.
We haven't either been billed or what. So that number will go down. I know we're going to, you know, have to pay those bills. And then also, we haven't been billed for Marshwood after school busing at all. There's nothing spent, and I haven't seen any bills, so... I don't know if you would like me to reach out to them or just let it ride or...
Well, no. No pun intended.
Yeah, exactly.
Let it ride to one stop. No, we'll I think it's worth reaching out just to
maybe students. Are we still getting counts?
No, we don't. don't, we never got official accounts from Marshwood. We got them when we were paying for buses, our own bus, to do it. We got accounts then. But we never really got, unless we asked for accounts. I think the reaching out, I think I would suggest that the reaching out be, let's get counts from them for the even last, you know, whatever they have before, the last couple of weeks. And then, of course,
and the
buzz.
Will they have counts?
Yeah, they do know who rides the bus. They know how many kids they drop off at the region.
Oh, okay.
They have in the past. So I'm assuming they have a rough idea of who rides the bus. And as I look through it, also, there are a number of things that are unencumbered that will have money.
Yeah,
coming
out. I mean, I need to know trash removal, utilities, yeah. Things like that will be ongoing. So
yes, and I actually quite a list. So when we look at that huge figure at the bottom, it is nowhere near accurate.
No.
It is I would say that we're probably looking at I think we're comfortable. I think we're looking right now at returning to the town, depending on how things turn out, about $100,000. Probably what it looks like. Which I believe is about what we did last year.
Yes.
Which is always nice. One of the things that, of course, we don't know if we're going to get the grant. We're crossing our fingers that we do, but it looks like we can also afford to do the things we wanted to do, even if we don't get it. And if we do get it, we could probably return a little more.
Yeah.
Well, you'll still have to pay a portion of that grant anyway.
Yes.
Yeah, a portion of it has to be.
And other budget questions, things people noticed on the budget? Could someone tell me which revenue input is actually the, doesn't look like we have an actual Title I, where the free and reduced, the
Title I doesn't show on here. This is your general fund budget.
Okay.
Title I is a grant budget, so
fund. So what's affected by the...
it would be your adequacy grant.
The adequacy grant. So that's affected, but it's not...
Well, no, because Title I would be funding for next year, not for the current year.
Right. But I mean, it's currently $652,000.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And we're not going to say it's going to, is it going to...
It was already going down for next year,
right.
If you remember in your budget.
Yes, I do.
It was like 50-something thousand dollars. And
it went down 50,000
already.
And it's going to go down...
That was before we found out about the free and reduced loans.
And it's going to go down considerably more.
That I don't know.
That,
it's
okay.
Based on so many different factors and a complex formula that...
Yeah.
Well, and one of the things we talked about, too, was, there's... You get different numbers. You get an estimated number for adequacy aid, and then there's this guaranteed 95% of that estimate. And so the question that we've talked about is whether or not, is 95% really guaranteed if you have this reduction in your free or reduced lunch? And you can see that 95% guaranteed is what it's in high. However, we won't know, and we don't get those figures.
September, late
right.
September, early October.
So when we're well into the
right. Which is what happened in some
so
of
so
right.
and that's a little
terrible.
That's a little scary.
Yeah,
yeah.
It is
a terrible scary.
Yeah.
So that's why the 95% guarantee would be important if
right. Once we get clarification on where you stand. Because the other thing we're looking at is whether or not there used to be a hold harmless clause. So, like, as you were talking before about boxing up and how crazy that sounds, that if you did have this drop in your funds and you couldn't, offer services, that you would still be allowed, I think that would be the whole harmless piece, that you could still use things and see where you are after the second year. Caroline's understanding is that hold harmless provision was removed when the law was reauthorized.
Mm-hmm.
So she's, Kate said, pounding the pavement and saying, really? It just seems very counterintuitive that you have this box of wonderful supplies and technology and everything sitting in a closet that you can't use.
I will say when they audit us, though,
we have to keep an inventory list that everything has to be tagged, that it was purchased with federal funds, and the auditors do look at that to make sure that it's being used just for Title I purposes.
So more to follow, it just makes it hard to make decisions.
And that's next year's budget, so it doesn't really affect this year's budget, because we saw as if we can carry the money over, we can't. So we're not allowed to do that, so. So, any other budget questions or comments or observations?
I just had, not specific to this, but in your next packet, I didn't make it into this packet, but next month you're going to see some 10-cent increase for your meal prices for next year, because we have to do that by law.
Right.
So that will be coming in May, I just didn't make it here.
Okay.
And then I want to get the budget for next year put up online, so if we could have a talk at some point about what kind of report you want to see with the different lines that we talked about not showing for HIPAA reasons and things like that. So I can get that up on the website at least, and...
Yep, let's do that very, actually, if people don't mind, we could do a very, I think we could do a very quick, I brought an example so that people can see it. So, the HIPAA regulations are such that what people get for health insurance should not be, is not public knowledge, should not be public knowledge, because it should never be, the premiums they're paying it's not a legal piece of information, it's not a public piece of information. So what we did this year, in the one that got published, is we had to go through and do this type of thing. Katie has found a way where she can summarize some of that stuff, so we aren't going through manually black things out. I think it's a nice format, and I would say, since we're not tied to anything, and I know, and I did not bring the example of the format that you had, I apologize. I would feel uncomfortable that we could direct Katie to put up the one that she has come up with that seems like the most straightforward one, fewest changes and the most straightforward one, to be the one that she puts up on the website so we have next year's budget up, and then we could all look at it once it's up and say, yeah, that seems to be working.
And then it would be used going forward when we present the budget and all of that, it would be the same report we use, so that nobody can...
So does it make sense to have it just in a place where we can all go look at it? And,
I can certainly email it to you, too, if you want to take a look at it before I actually put it out.
Well, we all have such great luck loading these
things. I know. It's basically the same report that you're getting in your packet every month, except it just collapses it down into, so it's not all detailed.
Yeah.
It still gives you the same information, it just collapses it down.
So I think, so my consensus is to put that up, and we'll see, sort of take a look at it.
And then I know the schools already changed their schedule, but the bus routes were revised and uploaded to the website as well for parents. With the different times of pickup.
Oh, for the year.
It's been literally seamless. It's been incredible.
What? No calls on bus stops?
First student has been unbelievably helpful. Like,
good.
Super great. I can't believe Lisa was amazing.
I haven't heard of any complaints.
That's good. That's excellent. Great. Thank you.
I think that's it.
Well, it's good. I mean, it was just a lot. As we get to the end of the year, it gets busier a bit. Starting next year, it gets busier and busier. All right, so the new business, the principal of the principal search process and update on how the principal search process is going. You know, we can't get too much detail, but I'll just Lori start, and then we'll hear from our folks.
We're moving forward. We met three times, I think, our committee has. There are 10 of us total. Andrea and Aaron are on the committee. We have a parent, and we have six staff, and then myself. We have looked at EdApps, the applications that came in. We looked at our own priorities and created a list of, you know, those kind of attributes that we were looking for, and then made decisions about which applicants we wanted to move forward. So last night, we had a bit of a marathon session at the SAU office. We interviewed our candidates, and of those, we've moved forward.
seen, you know, we went through the interviews, it was clear, you know, what kind of, you know, they kind of separated themselves and what we thought might make the most sense for the school. So we want to keep moving, and, you know, if it all comes to be, we have a name. I know one of the things we wanted to talk about was the board's possible, you know, interface with the candidate. And I don't know if either of you had any other thoughts about that as we, you know, move forward with this process.
Well, I think we wanted to discuss, you know, we weren't sure what the expectations were, if we needed to, going to bring forward two candidates, you know, since two are moving forward, do we want those two to come to the board, or do we want the committee to narrow it down? If the committee chooses to decide that, and bring that one candidate to board, or leave it open for two, or wasn't how we did it earlier, and what were the expectations and the rules, or
where else? The books here.
I think the only board member who's been involved in hiring a superintendent, a principal, is Tom.
That's right.
And so, were you presented with more than one principal candidate? And was there more than one?
No.
When Kate was hired?
No.
I was on the selection.
Oh, you were
the
principal.
Well, you know what the expectation? I wasn't a board member, but I was on the selection.
So, I mean, I think first of all, we have to see what the next step goes,
this
right?
This is like a box of pizza, though. You know, it's here on the sign. You try all the rest, now try the best.
That's right. But so Tom, to bring you up today quickly, there are two principal candidates that are moving on to the next step, which is them spending a day here, correct? Are there, what else is the community doing anything else? Are they going to their places? Are they?
How many candidates were there told?
To start with.
Okay.
We talked about that a little, you know, without getting again into too many details. Not everyone is in a current admin position, so depending on what you're looking for. Mm-hmm. So I did have some correspondence with some of the staff today. So we'll figure out what makes the most sense. I think you'll be able to tell a lot by what happens in this building. But, you know, we certainly can arrange that as well. I don't know, you know, what we're looking for, what are you trying to gather from that? So that's the email that I started at 9 o'clock this morning and didn't get to send back out. It was a busy day. So that's, you know, just kind of ferreting out what that would be. So the question was kind of, you know, does the board want to, you know, again, do you want to, you know, have a kind of a more informal conversation with the, you know, we move one forward. If the committee recommends one person, you know, if we come to consensus on that as a committee, you know, do we bring that person to you to have you meet the person and have the, you know, again, not necessarily a formal interview, but we have one to be, certainly be able to meet and have some conversation with this person. You know, I'm not sure. I just want to make sure that we're procedurally how we, you know. We,
and I don't know. You'll have to forgive me and please pardon my tardiness. Talk about the two candidates, not names, but anything about them that leads you to believe one over the other?
I don't think we're there yet.
Okay, that's
whatever. It's two experienced administrators. That's and I guess is what I've heard.
Yes.
And I think so.
No sense repeating yourselves. I don't want you to have to go through. But if there's
we're trying to figure out what board interaction should take place now. So will, once they have agreed to come to spend a day here, I assume their names are public at that point.
Well, if they're coming here.
Yeah.
They will be. You know, my plan was after I got, you know, we worked through the schedule and all, then we'll make it public. I hadn't done that.
No, I was thinking more of them, that they're aware that at a certain point in the next week or so, or whatever it is, their names will be public.
Are they currently working?
Yes.
Okay. Just out there.
No, they're not.
Well, I think that's your point.
Yeah.
Right. So they needed to know from me this afternoon whether or not they were going to move forward. So
there were two
moments. Right.
And I guess, you know, I don't know what the day here is. But what it's going to be, are they both going to be on the same day? And is it going to be different days? So So what do we, you know, maybe some of us can make time to be part of that day. Those, two board members have already met these people. And I think, and I don't know what the committee is looking to glean from that day, but I mean, then the committee, I think, should have a go at, well, this one clearly, or that one clearly stood out, and then get a sense.
Yeah, I kind of feel like if the committee is torn, I'm fine with them bringing two people, but if they, I mean, if the committee is like definitely this person, I'm good with that too, you know, just bring one for it. But if it's like, half of us like this one, the other half like this one, and they want to bring two people in front of us, to, I'm fine with that.
That's not a bad idea. I mean, you've got the candidates. I mean, if they're, you know, it's just an opportunity for, you know, all of us to maybe ask a couple questions. Maybe some of us have some other stuff that wasn't, you know, discovered during the initial last 7 days. Because this is, we're hoping that, I think I speak very, we're hoping we're not going to have to do this again anytime soon. You know, it's a process. And I think that it's gives from, you know, real stability for a while.
And what about, I mean, we all remember, because it was very recent, there was not a huge turnout for a Bob announcement during a public session, but do we think parents here, one school, do we think parents need to have some interaction? It's not going to go into that.
We talked about it, but we had that same concern that it was so, you know, that it doesn't tend to draw. Mm-hmm. You know, we did talk about maybe doing it like something in the morning.
Because if we did it sort of before school, parents could come, but if they didn't come, then staff would still be there, so it wouldn't be so sparsely attended.
That was one idea that was thrown out as far as before, that maybe the beginning of the day,
coffee.
They were coming.
Coffee.
Yeah.
I feel like you did that with Bill. We had a breakfast thing. Furbush.
Yeah. And did you get much of?
Everybody likes breakfast.
Probably like 10.
Well, I know, I chose them. It's breakfast.
I certainly do. Especially the babies.
We also thought
that's why we wanted to talk about it, because, you know, if we want, how do we want it, and we want to make sure.
What's your end date? I guess that's the question.
If it all comes together, we would have a name for you at your next meeting, at your May 10th meeting.
But not just a name, but a person to talk to. I mean, to do the more formal.
Well, that's the one of the questions. Do you want to do a formal interview, or, you know, I'm not sure, you know.
Or just have them come to the meeting, you know, and then that would, we could put it out there to the community, you know, that they can come and before.
Except if that person sort of already.
Let's talk dates, people.
I think that what you're saying, Aaron, is a very good point. And while the committee is maybe bringing one person forward, it's still the board's decision whether or not that person is going to be hired. Now, obviously, if they don't come in, if they come in and I don't know what, I mean, I don't know what they could do. however they could do things. And Tom is a wonderful example of a former superintendent candidate who was not hired. Someone came in and they refused to meet with us because their jacket was locked in the car. That would be a reason that not a very flexible person, and therefore we would not want to hire them.
I just don't think there's any harm, though, in have two finalists not to have that opportunity, unless their one is just far above the other, you know, which I don't know. So,
all I'm saying is this: that I don't know if we want to take. It's more time for everyone to come to. Just a lot more time. If indeed it comes down to one very specific person.
But it's time well spent, because I mean, if we have, depending on what that screening committee has found, you know, unless that other person aren't as good.
Let's say that right now it's like this, and in the next thing it's going to go like this. Do we still want to see both?
No.
That's what we're saying.
If it's not at that level.
So if it's clearly,
if they're
equal, Yes, we would see both. If they're not equal, if one's, we would see both. And I like the idea of having, I like the idea of having them come to our next meeting. Bob Godomsky will be here, hopefully the new principal candidate will be here. Maybe we'll start earlier.
You know, it would give us an opportunity, and maybe we could do a robocall, you know, just let people know, hey, we've got a person coming in, and whatever, you know, the teachers.
Okay.
I think the person comes, you can have an informal interview.
Yeah, yes.
They can answer questions, you can ask me, it doesn't have to be like a formal sit-down interview, just sort of a casual dialogue, you can ask questions and have some say when the meeting's over, if that person leaves, you go into your job, you know, not on the side.
And I think it can be relatively well facilitated, it doesn't get out of hand, it doesn't go on for an hour. And maybe we think about starting at 6 o'clock.
That's fine.
So I think we would look to that, right, so.
I am talking.
And we expect it to be one of those two.
I'm only worried about leaving home.
But don't forget, they have two now that they're looking at. And we have a vacation.
Well, there's a vacation week in there.
And there's a vacation week, if they're.
It's really two vacation weeks.
Yeah, right, and if they're working in New Hampshire, it's two vacation weeks, right?
Yes.
We've already started talking in-house, they've already asked me to start looking at Wednesday and Thursday of the week we get back from vacation, New Hampshire vacation. So they've asked me to sort of think about what that day could look like based on previous experiences and how it would work here, so teachers could all get to filter in because of duties, and then potentially morning time, then what classrooms they could potentially visit while they wait, because the morning will be open, then classrooms, and then lunchtime for teachers. So they've already asked us to start building a schedule that Wednesday and Thursday for the two candidates that are moving forward.
Excuse me,
I don't know who they are, but I'm working on the schedule.
So let's see, so we're going on vacation next week, and the week after Maine is on, New Hampshire is on vacation, and perhaps these people are working in New Hampshire and therefore have vacation.
So they're available for the day.
So what we're looking at is that they would come in here, and then we're really talking
25th, 26th, 2 weeks.
Now, but what you're really saying is do we want to meet earlier? That's what you're really saying, right?
Well, and that was one of the things we talked about too. Is that you want to wait till May 10th?
Yeah, I mean,
if they're coming in here
25, 26, can we just meet the night of the 26th?
I will not be here.
I will not be here.
No, that's not a big deal.
I think the other thing to think about is that you're going to want the feedback of the people in this building on the 26th. So, what I've seen effective is like exit slips. They rate what they pick up on, and that goes back to the committee. The committee needs time to process that. I don't process that. I don't think you can do that on the
27th. So we get that by the 27th or the 30th.
So is there really any harm in waiting? I guess that's my question. Is there any harm in waiting?
Well, Emily, go ahead. I would say if these people are out looking for a job, it's not likely that we're the only establishment that received an application from them. So. We could do May 3rd.
I mean,
so
we could do May 3rd.
First, second, or third?
Can we move our school board meeting to the first week for that one?
Well, if we get out, but we want them here for that day now.
Yeah.
Then I think we're obviously showing some interest, you know.
Well.
We want you back. We want you back.
I'm assuming that Lori's letter to them says, congratulations, you are one of two finalists, and we're very excited. Whatever, I don't know, it's something we're very excited about this.
Yeah, I had a phone call with that. I mean, today was really establishing if they were available. So this is, you know, it's like kind of like taking baby steps in a sense of trying to like put this process together.
Yeah, were they?
You know, just because if neither of them were available or neither of them wanted to continue the process, then it would
right,
be a different conversation.
It's a different conversation.
Right, exactly. So we're fortunate that, you know, the two that we wanted to move forward have agreed. They're both available on the day. Like, okay, so now it's getting, we're going to need the committees and we need to meet again to focus, kicks in to process the information that we gather from that day. Because they're both great. They're different people, you know, so it's
it's not, I wouldn't say there's a clear, I don't think that the group is there yet with a clear for second. You know, I think that's why we wanted to do the visit.
Yep, and that's not gonna, so that can't happen until before like the 27th or 30th, when the committee gets together again, right? If we're looking at dates here. So then we're looking at.
30th through 4th is that next week, 10th is our meeting.
Yep. So I really don't know what the time will be. How much.
And also then we would need to see if the candidate was even available for any night that we chose to have a meeting. We chose that first week in May.
They kind of, yeah, they cater to you.
Yeah, I was gonna say.
Right, what's going on in their life, that's, they're gonna cater to you if they want the job.
I was gonna say, they're local.
All right, cool. Oh, I mean, it's.
Yeah, it's not something.
Yeah, if somebody's working here or something.
Unfortunately.
Well, come on, freedom, here they come.
Come on, trip.
Especially if it's, you know, after they're leaving school, it's like.
I mean, I don't know if it, you know, as I think about, you know, the committee getting back together because of the vacation, because of the dates, you know, I'm not sure it makes sense to try to condense it anymore. If you weren't meeting until later in May, then I'd say, well, you maybe want to try to move it up, but, or it's May 10th, you know. And especially if I can give them dates, you know, and I will continue to be in touch with them through the process, so, you know.
And I would also say that I believe the decision will be made the 10th. I mean, they can leave the room for 10 minutes and then be told, you can come back in, because.
Right, my hope is that, you know, my intent would be to bring you a nomination.
Yeah.
You know, that this is the candidate, I'd like to narrow some more, and I'd like to bring you a nomination. I'd like you to be able to have an informed argument, we can talk about, and if you say, oh.
Stop talking, children.
Okay, so.
You need one of those? This is next year, you know.
Well, I assumed it's last year's. Thank you.
So, okay, so the two meetings happen, the two school visits happen, the committee gets back together. Say that happens on April 30th, let's say, about the next Monday. If on April 30th, that the committee has one person that they absolutely, you're the only person, will you then email that person the next morning and say, you're the one person that we're bringing forward, so that they are clearly aware?
Just have to wait to make that.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Pretty sure, like, yes.
We'll be getting back on May 10th.
You're our one. Okay.
Yeah, yeah.
I just told you.
Yeah, no, yeah, we're on call.
If we have one.
Just, you know.
So I mean, I don't know, that sounds like a good plan. Now, Kate has recently been through the process, so if she would like to offer any pieces of.
So I asked Stratum to move it up, not for Stratum or for me, but because of the building that people work in. So this is an administrator that has experience, and they're leaving their building, that's a hard place to be in that ambiguous state. Is the person leaving us, are they staying? That's part of the relationships in the building, and the person, it's stinky position. And the longer that is, the longer that the current staff or those people work are living with that. And that's really hard, because you care about your faculty and your staff and your relationships. In my mind, if you could, there's no other reason, why wouldn't you put your meeting on the 3rd? And for their sake and your sake, I guess is my feeling.
Well, a couple of things, you said you asked, I mean, neither of these people have asked yet, right?
I'm a very appreciative person.
Yes.
They may not ask, but we really appreciate it. I mean, I don't know, I just think it's a hard position for people to be in, to know that someone is potentially leaving that you may not want to leave or you're excited for, but I mean, it's just a hard thing, and with 2 weeks of vacation, you're now even drawing it out even further. It's not, and you're now looking at 5 weeks, right? 4 weeks, that's a long time.
That's a good point.
When you're looking for a job, even if they say you've got it until you get the contract.
That's true.
It's very stressful.
Meanwhile, you're still looking, because all of a sudden.
Yeah, it can always take place.
Our principal changed her mind, she's not leaving.
Oh.
And we're not sorry. Yeah, so I think that's an excellent point.
Is there a reason that it wouldn't, is like May 3rd already full for people? Is there a reason, like, does it affect posting for the community, the town, you know, you're moving your school? I don't know those things, I'm just feeling like.
I don't think.
5 weeks is a long time.
I don't think it's the town, as you can see, I don't think it's the town that would be too concerned about it. Bob Budomski is someone who may not then be able to attend.
That's a great thing.
Meeting.
Yeah, that's a great thing.
But that would be the biggest, that would be the biggest thing.
Let's find out if he can move it.
Okay.
And if he can, let's move it.
Took it to the third.
To the third.
The whole meeting from the 10th, from the school board meeting itself?
Yep. So we don't move twice.
We can do that, I wasn't certain.
It will make for a long meeting because it is May and we will be looking at funds that we have available. It'll be a long meeting, just letting you all know that. We would start at 6 o'clock.
I prefer one long meeting to two shorter ones any day of the week.
Just letting you all know, it's going to be a long meeting. It'll be a long meeting, whether we did it the third or the 10th, it'll be a long meeting, so.
I have a list. Page 10.
So, all right, so, I can actually draw Bob, I've already been in touch with him about being here, so I can check in with Bob on that. I believe Bob is attending the SAU meeting on the 10th.
So, the 7th.
That's right, I don't know what, that's ours, the 10th.
I know why, we should almost try to figure out what their board meeting dates are, if they're already scheduled before we contact him. He does Cole Brown, right?
He's got five.
What he did tell me was that Thursdays tend to be meeting days for him, he was a little surprised that actually May 10th was the day.
All right, so is.
Well, ours doesn't have to be the third, it could also be the second, right? First or second.
Right.
It could be the first, second, or third, correct?
Well, that's a bad day for him, then we should avoid it at all costs.
I don't, I have to ask him, he just said Wednesdays and Thursdays tend to be his meeting days, when we were talking about science.
How flexible are we on the days then?
I'm flexible, completely flexible.
May day.
My only concern is that, earlier in the week that you push it, it's going to be tough. You've got to get a date set for that committee.
The committee has.
Yes, that's true. That's true, so what is.
We've been meeting on Thursdays, that seems to be a day that works for folks.
May 3rd is the Northwood School Board meeting.
Thank you.
So could the committee then plan to meet that Thursday, the 26th, after the 27th? Because then they can take all the students that back to feedback. And you said Thursday, so the day we're meeting, makes sense to try to do it, yeah, it's too long.
And then we could meet.
Or Nottingham, or.
It's got Nottingham, Stratford.
And Stratford.
Cole Brown. And you've got Northwood.
Northwood is the third, they have their.
May 2nd is Nottingham.
Okay, yeah, that's why.
Aren't you glad I keep up on all this stuff?
It's been my birthday.
Can't just get it.
Monday.
Which is the Monday, the 7th?
It must be nice.
The 7th?
The 30th. April.
We can't do the 7th, we have so much to settle.
No, no, the 30th.
Oh, I thought you said the 7th.
No, no, that's what I was saying. I didn't know when everyone's birthday was, she expected us all to know.
No, I counsel.
Not on the 30th.
Oh, no, I thought they said the 7th.
All right, well, let's figure out which day we're.
Let's back up a little bit. I know that we don't want to do two meetings, but this is an important decision, and maybe we do break it up.
All right.
Maybe we meet the 30th, if that works, or the 3rd, yeah.
Okay.
Or the 3rd.
It might be less complicated.
What is that?
And really, and it would just be to meet on the principal.
Yeah.
I know we have either budget or policy.
That's a Monday.
It's not much work, that's.
Not budget, and I don't have policy in there.
Yeah, I know it's one of them, it's either budget or policy.
Budget is the first.
All right, so.
Okay, so policy is the 31st. Oh, the 30th, I should say.
Okay, so you could do that anyway, so let's think.
Is the 2nd one for you guys?
We're looking at May 2nd right now, Wednesday, works for me.
I know I have it too, Monday, Tuesday.
And we'll just do that, we'll do that without Bob, and he'll be here on the 10th, we'll be here on the 10th.
And the new principal could potentially come on the 10th as well.
The new principal could potentially come on the 10th, all right. So we will meet the 2nd.
Here or at the SAU office?
Here, it's just going to be the school. And it make it, if we open it, you know, we'll open it up, but, you know, staff, teachers, parents, anyone who wants to be here.
6:30?
6 or 6:30, what works for you?
6:30 is better.
6:30.
To say that.
Okay, and that would be for a principal nomination, right? Now, if anything happens between now and then, we'll try to be flexible. But to the point of trying to get it done, I think it's important. It's nice to see your, everyone's hard work come to fruition as quickly as possible.
Thursday evening, Saturday.
And keep the town, the town's taken care of.
May 2nd, 6:30.
It was hoped.
Here.
All right, anything else on this that we want to?
Principal.
The children at the other end are just chatting away.
We're not chatting, this is important school board scheduling stuff.
Okay.
You can have to separate them.
Please, I know. All right, so we're looking at the 2nd, 6:30, and then it's still the 10th. Any other comments, concerns?
Perfect.
Ooh, thank you for that wonderful update. Already mentioned we're doing the contract signing. I don't think we have any update on community connections. You guys have been working on this committee instead, doing that stuff. Marshwood contract items, nothing to update on. Late start Marshwood, I don't think there's anything new.
No, just they will be having another meeting on April 23rd. But unfortunately, it's from 2:30 to 4 in the afternoon. That just does not work for me. Certainly, if anybody else happens to be free on that day and wants to attend, they have been great about giving me an update, though. I will say that.
That's awesome.
And that's what counts. Some of the things that we usually do around this time of year is we plan our board retreat. And we also try to plan when it's come down to be now an annual meeting with Marshwood. And I am suggesting this year that we wait until Bob comes on board and that we even discussed a time with him to do it over the summer. Kind of, you know, get when he's here on the 10th, we can discuss when we can put that stuff in. So we're putting that aside. All right. Future meetings are in there, school events are mostly.
Can I just make one comment? Mm-hmm. The SAU meeting says it's at Robinson Grade School, but it's actually at Mulligan's Room. There's some people are aware they don't come here. Can you say you can?
Why, thank you.
I'm getting officers that day.
Yes, officers that day.
I better show up or I'm going to get.
Yeah, I'm not going to be going on for all of showing up, so you can say, where?
Let me put it this way, you better show up, because otherwise you do get elected.
It's also at 5:30 and not 6:30?
It's at 5:30?
We got moved.
What? We got moved to 5:30.
I see a president in the making.
Did you all just hear this? It's at 5:30. That's kind of early.
5:30 for the SAU.
Budget presentation at City Hall.
That night?
Yes, at 6:15.
We're going to make it.
I have an.
I'm going to three times.
Wait, I'm sorry. It's 5:30, 7, so you need it. CTC,
it's a Mulligan's Room.
No.
Is there a reason why they're not having it at the SAU?
I think, I'm not sure she's, I'm not sure the posting went out yet for this one.
I had 6:30, so, but.
Yeah, it was originally. But we, like you said, we have to go in front of City Council in terms of assuming there are current budget situations, so.
Oh, you're talking about the summer's worth?
Well.
Oh, okay.
SA, yes, SA, you got moved to 5:30, because we have already had City Council at 6:15.
It's all about you.
Well, it's all about City Council. They picked it, not us.
It's at 5:30, and you have to leave at 6 o'clock. So we're having a half hour meeting.
Don't have a lot on the agenda.
You talked about the SAU?
Yeah.
Well, you've got officers to select, so. Don't you miss that? I'm going to pick you for president.
I was going to say.
Chair. Because you can't be chair, yeah, whatever.
Well, I could be, but do I get 2 votes?
That's because you're great at it.
You're the only one who can do it. All right, we'll discuss that afterwards. All right. So meetings are in there, 5:30. Thank you for letting us know, because none of us were shown up until 6:30. And somebody would have elected one of us, chair, so, you know, maybe. Any other school events coming up, Kate, that you want?
Not that I didn't review at the beginning.
You already reviewed it, thank you very much. Closing comments by visitors.
Celia Leopold, 426 Washington Street. I was wondering if the board has considered lengthening the school day so we don't run into the issue of having to make up so many hours or days at the end of the year for next year or future years, instead of starting maybe at 8:40, starting at 8:20 from the beginning of the year. I know for me and some of the parents I've talked to, it's been difficult to transition the kids to a new schedule this late in the year. We've already got a schedule set up and now we're making a new schedule. And like Kate said, not only are the teachers exhausted, but the students are coming home even more exhausted. And when they're already in a routine for 6 months and they've got a set bedtime, and now we're extending the school year, that infringes on activities that they've already signed up for and so forth. So I'm wondering if there's a way that the board might be able to lengthen the school day from the beginning and maybe consider changing the hours so that when we get to this point in the year, it's not such a drastic change. I know my son, had it been a couple weeks earlier, I would be pulling him out of school every week to make it to his after-school activities.
So. Excellent observation. I think that probably over the summer we'll be having some discussions about how to deal with snow days and things as we go forward. So.
I know Kate talked about dyslexia. There is a dyslexia center out of Rochester that you might want to contact. I know they train people to work with dyslexia students. I have a friend who works with them. And I just had a couple of questions about the principal's search committee and the meet and greet. As a parent, it would be great if you're gonna do a meet and greet that there is either childcare provided or a length of time that the parents could come in and meet them. In the mornings, not typically good for many parents who are rushing to get their kids to school on time and then may have to rush somewhere else to take another one to daycare or rush off to work. So I prefer evenings, that's just me. I can't speak for other people. But it's also difficult because my kids are home and I can't come on a Tuesday night because my husband's working. And my husband and I both want to meet the principal. So what do we do with our kids? Except bring them along and then disrupt your meeting. So either put out a list or something when you do a robocall, give parents a couple weeks notice, give us a chance to sign up so we can take turns watching each other's kids, allow the staff maybe to sign up so that we can meet the principal if they've already had the opportunity to meet the new principal. And then I was wondering, how was the search committee formed? How was the public notified that you were doing a search committee, and was it put out there so that anybody could sign up? You said you had one parent, two school board members, and several faculty and staff members, half a dozen or so. It would seem to me that you would want one or two more parents on that committee.
I'll address that. We've been discussing it since we knew of Kate's resignation, of how it would be formed, and we wanted it as lean and a committee as possible to be able to move as quickly as possible. So the board decided on this makeup of it. And while if they said one parent, it was actually more parents because we have parents on the board also. So they were sort of doing double duty. So that was the board's decision, and we wanted to move as quickly as possible, knowing that time was of the essence. So we did that. I don't believe any of us are committed to a meet and greet. It would be sort of at the convenience of candidate as well as other things, and you will have ample opportunity to meet the principal once the principal is hired, obviously. So plenty of opportunity to interact.
And if my other suggestion would be to coordinate maybe with the town website, because we get email blasts from the town. So I don't know if there can be any crossover that somebody sends something to the town webmaster saying the school is having a meet and greet, because some of the parents who may have opted to send their kids to other schools might consider coming back here if they have an opportunity to meet the new principal.
Yeah, yes, I mean, and absolutely. I know that the meet and greet for Dr. Gudomski was on the town website.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank you.
We do not have many people show up for that. It's just the way it happens, but anyway.
So as of right now, though, we know May 2nd we are having.
Yeah, as of right now, it is planned for May 2nd.
And that would be open to the public to come and ask questions in the beginning and the end, just like our normal meeting.
Well, actually, it would even be more interactive because it's just going to be for the principal at that point, so.
So the community at that meeting.
Yes, it could be, it'll be well facilitated, it will keep it well in hand for the other members.
Right.
And I think too, there's enough time between now and then that people will be able to get their schedules, you know, to be able to go. I agree with you, I think this is a good opportunity to meet for parents to meet the principal. It's unfortunate, it's tough with scheduling for everybody to be able to attend, but I think if there's enough time between now and then.
We should try and have childcare.
Yeah, I was going to ask if there's any opportunity for any of the middle or high school kids that might be moving in that direction to assist with that, if that's something that they might want to get involved in.
Oh, that's cool. I would actually.
I don't know, I was going to say, if she's around, I would.
Yeah, I think if anyone has teenagers or younger students who would like to do it, but I would also put it, Celia works with the rec committee, and they're the ones who know the counselors and people who are available, so we are willing to pay. So, I mean, if you can provide childcare, that's, you know, if you can provide people, we are willing to pay for it.
I can get in touch with the rec director and let them.
No, it would not be our, we're not, no, never mind.
No, why?
We're going to do it right now.
We were just talking, our daughters aren't, they don't have practice, but they would, no.
Okay, we'll have to be decided, yeah, we'll need to know.
Yeah, as long as I know the date.
So this meeting will need to be posted, obviously, and once it's posted, and if daycare is going to be available, if childcare is going to be available, it should be in the posting.
It will be available. We'll make it available.
Okay, and I'm also going to provide a different contact list for posting here in town, because I think there's one person we can send to here in town that is not currently on the posting list, who makes sure it actually gets on the town website and other places as well. So we'll just get, I'll get that squared away with Carol so that that happens. That way it's sure to go out. Anything else, Celia?
Just to follow up on that, there, I don't know if it came to the school board, but I'm a post through the town frequently, so the town does now have an email address that all the postings can go to, and it'll get to the town website, the library, the post office, and all to the town places. The chairman of the select board could probably give you that information, and even if you could just get it out with pending childcare, and then that gives parents more notice now to plan their schedules to be here.
Thank you, Celia. Nancy?
Yes, I just have a quick question. I heard you talking about changing the school year next year for Summersworth. Are we having any kids over in Summersworth next year?
No. It was not to change it for Summersworth. It is so that our teachers are part of mm-hmm. SAU 56, and it's to allow them to have professional days, professional workshop days with their counterparts, so that it doesn't stay in our small school. They get to get out. They get out to the broader world of Summersworth too, and meet with a broader range of.
Okay, that explains it better.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Any other comments, questions, concerns? All right. Any comments by the board? All right. Thank you very much. We do have non-public. We will roll call. We are going to non-public for personnel.